I know this is a day that we dread, but it's a day we all face. And I just want to say before I start prayer, it has been a wonder to have John as my neighbor for the last 20-something years. We moved beside John somewhere around 1995, and we've had a great, couldn't have a better neighbor in all the world. Matter of fact, we couldn't have a better neighborhood than what we live in. We live in the greatest neighborhood, I say, in Waycross, Georgia. And I'm going to miss John, miss him dearly. Let us pray. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, Lord, we praise and thank you for being our God, our Creator. You formed us, breathed life into us, and Lord, you give us life and you take our life. But Lord, we know that our life goes to be with you. Lord, our body may go to the grave, but Lord, our spirit goes back to you, the preacher said in Ecclesiastes. And Lord, we just praise and thank you today, Lord, that we've had this wonderful life before us of John Bennett. And Lord, that you bless his family and his friends here today, all of the loved ones. God, that you give them grace. Lord, that you give them peace. And Lord, we just praise and thank you, Lord, that we know that one day when we face our spirit leaving our bodies, we will go before you as well. We ask it all in the name of your Son. Amen.
We got to know Brother John over there at university, and Brother Peacock, of course, I'm one of his preachers, and he loved Brother John, Sister Beverly. He said he knew them about 40 years, so he thought a lot of them. He just wanted y'all to know that his prayers with y'all, and he hated to see him go, and we're going to miss him, too, at Christ Church. He come on Sunday mornings when he was able. But we appreciate their family so much. We'll be praying for y'all.
Sun, you work on earth this time. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today. I thank the family for ensuring that I would say the things that God would have us to say at a time and a place in all of our lives and around the world as we are all living and breathing right now. We have things are happening around us that are so unexpected, things that we're being alarmed by everywhere that we turn to. We're hearing about events that are taking place, and for some, they are trying to come up with an answer. Some are trying to bring about a conclusion and get everything back to normal again. I will tell you something, there will be no normal for anyone's life until we step out into eternity, into the presence of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to share with you three different passages of Scripture, and the first passage will deal with Brother John. I was his pastor when I came to Waycross, Georgia back in 1980, and there's only one thing that I never could figure out about him, and that was the handshake. If anybody can explain to me the handshake, I will appreciate it. It must have to do with flying an airplane. And I know that Jack and Jerry are not pilots probably because I don't get the same handshake. I tried for years and years and years and years to get a full grip on his hand, and you can never do it. Never do it. We're seeing the young and the old to die. We're seeing men and women. We're seeing fathers, mothers, it makes no difference. We're seeing all nationalities around the world, and even as we're here this evening, there's another strand of the virus that's started off in South Africa, they say, and dreading to see it spread. And nations around the world are closing their borders down from anyone coming out of South Africa right now. Again, do we have answers? We're struggling. We're striving to find answers. Moses wrote something unique in the Scriptures, something that we've heard about for most of our life, and especially for us that are retired. We appreciate just getting to the age 70 because Moses mentions this in one of the Psalms that he wrote. And I want to read the Psalm to you. It's Psalms chapter 90. It has a lot of meaning to it. It has a lot of power to it because it makes us to understand the same way that Abraham was in his journeys in this life. He said, my home is not here on planet Earth. And even though the Father God is sending me to a country, a land that I don't even know of, I'm just a pilgrim passing through the land. And that is all we are. And if we want to understand it even closer to our own, James said, life is nothing but a vapor. We're here one moment, we're gone the next. Listen to what Moses had to say. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations, even before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world from everlasting to everlasting. You're God. And folks, as soon as we can come to that conclusion by our own personal relationship, the better off we will be, that He is God. And He created us and He made us before He ever made a mountain. He knew about everything. You return man to dust and say, return, O children of man. For 1,000 years in your sight are but as yesterday when it is as the past or as a watch in the night. You sweep them away as with a flood. They are like a dream, like a grass that is renewed in the morning. And in the morning it flourishes and is renewed. In the evening it fades and it withers. For we are brought to an end by your anger. Is God angry with us? God's angry with the sin that's in the world, my friend. God's not angry with anyone. The Scripture tells us it's not the will of God that anybody would perish. And when we hear this word anger, it is because of the anger that God sees in a world that seems to have no limits to the sins that they'll commit, things that they will do. Completely contrary to God's word. For we are brought to an end by your anger, And by your wrath we are destroyed. You have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your presence. For all of our days pass away under your wrath, and we bring our years to an end like a sigh. And then verse 10 is one we're familiar with because it's one in the King James Version. It says that we're blessed to live 70 years, which is 70 years. 70 is a complete number in the scriptures. But it says in the ESV version here, the years of our life are 70, or even by reason of strength, listen to this now, maybe 80 years. We say, wow, I'd like to live to 70 or 80. We look around and I'll assure you, you'll find those in the hundreds around here.
There's a price to pay for that. He describes it.
Yet their span is but toil.
Whether it be 10 years, 20 years, 70 years, 80 years or 100, it is full of toil. You ever wonder the stress that you're under right now, thinking and listening to everything? You see, I've learned something in the past several years of my life. One of the things I've learned that if we will pay more attention to God and God's Word, and less to what the world is having to say, we find ourselves so much better off. So much better off. You see, the very writer of this psalm, he didn't even start his work career till he was 80 years old. That was Moses. And he lived to be 120, and during that last stint of his life, those 40 years, he went and, obedient to God, was able to go in and to help lead the children of Israel out of 400 years of bondage. But during that time, he became so impatient with people. Have you found yourself a little on edge with everybody that's around you? Even some of your family members you and I may be on edge with sometimes. Moses found himself at one point in time when God was giving him instructions to simply speak a word, he became angry. Bible says he struck a rock, and because of that he was not allowed to go into the promised land. He only got to view it from a distance. And I will tell us right now, as we live on planet Earth, the only thing you and I are doing right now as we live is viewing heaven. But one day, by God's grace, we will be able to go into heaven. Isn't that wonderful that God would allow us to get into heaven? What a wonderful thing. But listen to what he says here. But it's toil and trouble, and they are soon gone, and we fly away. Who considers the power of your anger and your wrath according to the fear of you? And so teach us to number our days. Listen to that verse 12. Make us to start numbering our days. You know how you number your days? One at a time. And today, it's been said, we've said this before, you've heard it before, today is the first day of the rest of your life. That's all we have. There's absolutely nothing that I can say to alter anything about Brother John. Not a thing. But he's made his decisions and his relationship with God in years past. He made his decisions. Those decisions are there, he's standing before God and having to give an account for all the things that God has done in his life. Listen to what Moses concludes here. Return, O Lord, how long? And have pity on your servants. That's the very next thing that Moses said. Lord, come on and get us all together. Take us all together and have pity on us. Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all of our days. You see, as we see those of our loved ones and family members that pass on, it's always difficult when tomorrow morning comes to wake up and to feel the hurt, to feel the separation, and to feel the loneliness that's there. We know that only God can fill that spot. doesn't mean that we don't have the attachments, and they will always be there. They will forever be there. And thank God for that. Thank God for the relationships that we all have. But listen to what he says here, and this is to be read and to be understood carefully. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, and for as many years as we have seen evil. How in the world do we stand before God and say, God, thank you for all these afflicted days that we have? Paul would later on say that, you know, these light afflictions that we're experiencing now are in no way to be compared with the great glory that we will experience when we enter into heaven, into the presence of God throughout all eternity. And as for many years, we have seen this evil. And that's for sure. I want us to be mindful of the evil that goes on in this world. You know, we're very fortunate. And if any of you that are here live in a big city, let me help you move out. Thank God for the smaller cities. We have a lot of problems. We have our own shares. But thank God we don't get to see the evil like some of these other places. And then the Bible says in the last two verses of this passage, Moses says, let your work be shown to your servants and your glorious power to their children. You see, we are all servants, every one of us. If you and I get up and begin to walk around on planet Earth in these last days as if though we're in a daze and don't know which way to turn, we've lost our ability to be a servant. We've lost our ability to help mankind and help one another. And it is so important that we understand, as God has placed us down here to be a servant, the same way that when he sent his son Jesus, Jesus was a servant. One of the last expressions of him being a servant was when he got down at the feet of his disciples and began to wash them. And there was one of the disciples that decided that, you know, I'm going to be a little different here, and I'm going to refuse Jesus when he comes by to wash my feet. And Jesus looked at Peter and said, Peter, if you don't allow me to wash your feet, you will have no part of me in the kingdom to come. I can without any doubt tell you that I've washed John Bennett's feet. Did it make me more like Christ? Yeah, it did. We don't do that anymore, folks. We run around hiding from each other. We run around trying to keep a secret life from each other. But when you can get down and become a servant like our Savior was, we'll learn a lot more about what heaven's going to be all about. It's not going to be about who sits on the front row, because some of his disciples, one of their mothers came to him and said, can you let one of the boys sit on one side of you and the other on the other side of you when they get to heaven? And Jesus said, you don't want to do that. It's not even my place to play who is going to be there and who's not going to be there. But let me tell you something, folks. I will tell you, unless we become a servant, we won't make it there. We won't make it there. And he says, in your glorious power to their children. So what we're doing as servants, as adults, is teaching our children how to be servants also. Teaching the little ones how to do the right thing in life. God help us all. We failed in that, by the way, so far. We're failing our children right now by not being the proper man and woman of God that we should be. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us. Let the favor of God be upon us. Is there anyone here that doesn't want the favor of God in your life? Folks, if there's ever been a time in all of history, it is right now that we need the favor of God. We're in a mess. It seems to only be getting worse. And for those that have gone by way of the grave, they've escaped in this right now. But us, we're yet to deal with this. And folks, I'll tell you something. If we do not get down on our knees before God, we're going to continue to fail at this thing. And he concludes this one passage, and establish the work of your hands upon us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. I didn't misread that. He said to establish our works upon us, the work of our hands upon us, and yes, establish the work of our hands, what we're doing. You see, Jesus said that anybody, we've got so much looking back right now, so many people that are looking over and seeing, well, what's going on back there? Jesus said something very important. He said, any man or woman that puts his hands to the plow and he looks back is not fit for the kingdom of God. Yes, these are days of mourning for many, many people. Folks, look over. There's tents everywhere. There are those that are hurting and sorrows there. But we must understand that there is an eternity before us. And every one of us have that moment and that time that we will step into eternity. And I would tell us all, check your hands. Check your hands. If you're like me, as the scripture tells me, I was born in sin. And the only way that my hands can be made clean is through the blood of Christ, through his forgiveness. Not only forgiveness of the things of the past, but also for the things of the present right now. Paul said in the Hebrew writing, he said, we have an advocate with the Father that if we ask him to forgive us, that means into the future that we can get that forgiveness and he can cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Another passage of scripture that I want to share with you is found in the Revelation. I've just got through doing this series on the Revelation, and we've just completed the very last. And when you get to the end of the Revelation, you know what it makes you want to do? Go back all the way to Genesis and start it all over again, because you find out what the real purpose of God was all about at the very beginning when he created man. And the Bible says when he got through creating man from the dust, the Bible tells us, he said, this is great. This is the right thing to do. This is the perfection of everything that I've done. And you see, when we read the Revelation, we find the perfection of God and all that God has in store for us. He writes to seven churches of what was an area called Asia Minor. It's a series of churches that each one had their problems and had their difficulties and their struggles, but he addressed the last church. It's a church in an area called Laodicea. It was a group of people that understood God, they believed God, but they lacked in a personal relationship with God. They struggled with it. And I believe that there are a lot of people that are trying to have a relationship with God by what they hear from preachers. Don't listen to preachers. Don't listen to preachers. You have to be careful. Not everybody that gets up behind a pulpit is necessarily preaching the Word of God. But always go to the Word of God first. Because one day we will stand before God and we will be judged out of his word. You see, this message in this time is not for John at all. It again is for us. It's a reminder to us about our own relationship with God. And if you want to know about your relationship with God, you turn around and look about your relationship with each other. And if it's not perfect, then your relationship with God is not perfect. I will tell you something. It's something that you will strive for and you will work with all the days of your life. Until you die, until you take your last breath, you will be working together with relationships and learning how to love each other and being able to look at each other and know that we're all different, but yet we have that common relationship of being able to have a likeness of God inside of us. He created us in his own image, as scripture tells us. And I would tell us as we are listening and we're hearing all kinds of messages today, please open up your word. If It's been a long time since you've opened up your Bible. I will encourage you to do that, because there is where you will find the avenue of life and the avenue that will carry you right on into heaven. Listen to what he says here to the Laodicean church. And to the angel of the church of Laodicea write the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. He's actually describing here, these are the words of Christ here, as there's being spoken to John. And he says, I'm telling you this because I was there at the beginning of creation. You want to know where Jesus was before you and I, before the cross, before all of the prophets? Jesus was right there with the Father at creation, according to what the Scripture says right here. Knowing from the beginning of time what life would hold for all. I know your works. That's alarming right there. Verse 15, he's telling this, which we believe is the church that represents the time we're living in right now. He says, I know your works. I will tell you right now, my friends, he knows everything about you and I. There's nothing a secret in any of our lives. I know your works. He says, you're neither cold and you're not hot. Wow. Not cold. You're not hot. I would that you were either cold or hot. Either you didn't know anything about me, had no desire to have any knowledge of me, or you had a real knowledge of me through my son, Jesus. I wish that you had one or the other, but you flounder around somewhere in the middle. Somewhere, whether you're not hot or you're not cold, you're just... You ever met so many people today that are indifferent? Opinion about anything anymore. You know, we need to be persuaded about the gospel. We need to be persuaded about the heights and the depths of the relationship that we all have with God. Because, my friend, there's coming a time when we'll stand before him. And how we know him will be based on how we will stand before him. How we know him is how we will stand before him. And I will tell you, from what I read in my Bible, when I stand before the presence of God, the first thing I will do is drop to my knees. I will drop to my knees. Listen to what he says. He says, so because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, he said, I will spew you out of my mouth. Something that's not pleasant there. That's what we do with anything that goes in our mouth that's not pleasant. We politely will get it out of our mouths. We won't try to digest it down. Maybe what we're experiencing today with all of the pandemic going around the world is God in the process of spewing us out of his mouth. Lord, help us. Lord, help us. Lord, help us. Have we caused a bitter taste in the mouth of God? Caused an unpleasantness there. You say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not really realizing that you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. The reason for that response by God to this church age is because they feel like they don't have any reason to have God in their life. I remember the statement that Stephen Hawkins made, very knowledgeable man, wheelchair bound for the last portions of his life. One of his conclusions was, his profound knowledge as a physicist, he said that he had concluded that man could have been created without a God. Did you hear that? We have a scientist, a knowledgeable man, and all of his knowledge just prior to his death was concluded that man could be made without a God. That's interesting, because the Scripture also tells us that the fool has said in his heart, there's no God. There's foolish people running around. I have no need for God in my life. Yet the Bible tells us we are standing without God. We are lost. We are undone. We're naked before God. Jesus says to this group, the shame of your nakedness may not be seen. And salve to anoint your eyes so that you may be able to see. Those whom I love, I reprove and I discipline. So be zealous and repent. Behold, and this is where I want to go to. This is verse 20, Revelation chapter 3. Behold, Jesus says, I stand at the door and I knock. We live in such a different time. When was the last time someone knocked on your door? Period. With the Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons unable to go around and go door to door, I dare say it's been a while since someone just knocked on our door. But I will tell you something, my friends. I personally believe that God's knocking on the doors of the world that we live in right now. And if anyone hears my voice and he opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. Whoever hears the knock and will rise. We've got lazy that we don't even want to get up. Go ask, answer the door. Ask who's there. Wow. He says, but if you'll do that, I'll come in and we will sit together and we will eat together. And I will come in with him and eat with him and he with me. And the one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. And he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. In other words, God is saying, this is about a relationship. In the days ahead, as we continue on, if the Lord blesses and the Lord chooses to allow us and you attend another funeral, it will be the same as this is right here. Everybody's looking around and saying, is that John's brother? Is that John's daughter? Well, who is that right there? It's all about a relationship, friend. It's about a relationship. It's important that we don't lose that relationship with one another because it is the evidence of the relationship we have with God. It's time that we knock on one another's doors to find out how each other's doing. And we need to spend more time together in prayer. We need to spend more time together in the Word of God, reading and studying. That's what they did in the early church. And the Bible says God blessed them. And we are soon, fast, I believe, approaching to a day and a time as it was in the early church where the Bible says that everyone sold everything that they had and everything became equal one with another. They shared that commonness together. That without the Lord, they could not make it. Folks, you and I won't be able to make it without our Lord. Paul wrote some astounding things that I want to conclude here that are, to me, that are some of the most important words in the Scripture. I'll begin those in verse 35 of 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And he talks about this person, this physical body. As I look around, there's young and old here, and there's even a baby walking up the aisle and a toddler right over here. And I pray for those little children. If there's ever been a day and a time that you need to take care of the little children, you and I better wake up and start doing it right now. If it's humanly possible with the help of God, we need to open our Sunday school classes up to make sure our children are being taught from the Word of God. But he talks about this person, this body. Paul is being addressed by this group of believers in his response, but someone will ask, how are the dead raised and what kind of body do they come? Will they come in? And Paul responds and says, don't go down that foolish pathway. Folks, if you haven't noticed recently, we're all getting older. Jack, I appreciate that comment that you made. He reminded me that I don't have as much hair on top as I used to have. Our skin is getting aged. There's just not enough that we can do to keep this youthfulness, because it's the process. It is the process. But he says, well, what's it going to be like when we get to heaven? How's this thing going to take place? And he says, quit thinking about your physical body. Quit thinking about your physical body. Lord, I've never seen so many people want to spend so much time on social media putting things about themselves on social media. If you're doing that, I warn you, you hear me, young and old and in between, you be extremely careful what you're doing there. There's a danger of self-indulgence and self-pride that can come up when we begin to display all of these things over social media. I've been concerned for a long time of churches that are putting things over the internet, putting spiritual movements over the internet. I'm concerned about those things because I think what God does in a person's life is very personal. And that is the reason that the Word of God tells us that every man and every woman, boy and girl, is to work out their own salvation with fear and trembling of God. The Bible tells us here, don't be foolish about this, you foolish person. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. What happens in your physical person and the word and the things that have happened in your life that are sown as a seed does not come about until you die. It's not how much you can accumulate in this life. It's not what all you can achieve in this life. It's what happens after you die and it goes into the ground. And what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. In other words, simply putting it, our physical body just goes right back where it came from. But there is an immortal side that Paul begins to address. And of all the things, and Paul is one of the most, of all men in the scriptures of writing, he wrote 13 books in the Bible. And he had such knowledge, and of his knowledge here, he didn't understand a whole lot about the resurrection until he had an experience, a personal experience with Christ on the road to Damascus. God touched Paul's life and made him be able to write these things to these believers. But God giveth it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. It's just a temple, it's just an outer shell. And we look around and we can look at each other and none of us look alike. Each one has his own distinction, but the soul is distinguishable. Now listen to what he says here. For not all flesh is the same, but there is one kind of humans and another for animals and another for birds and another for fish. And there are heavenly bodies and there are earthly bodies. But the glory of the heavenly is of one kind and the glory of the earthly is of another. There is one glory of the sun and another glory of the moon and another glory of the stars. And for stars differ from star to star in glory. And so it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. What is sown is perishable. What goes back continues to decay. But the other, the soul, is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Please hear that. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body, Paul says here. He says the two are inseparable until the time of God. Thus it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being, and the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. The first Adam, we know. We're suffering, and every hurt and every sorrow that you're witnessing is because of the first Adam, the failure that happened in the Garden of Eden. But the Bible now tells us through the second Adam, which is Christ, which is Jesus Christ our Savior, we now have everlasting life. But it is not the spirit that is the first, but the natural, and then the spiritual. The first man was from the earth, a man of dust, and the second man is from heaven. As was the man of dust, so also are those who are of the dust. In other words, just as those around us, and it's all over, all around us here, is of the dust, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we are born the image of the man of the dust, we shall also bear the image of the man of heaven, the very person of Christ. Christ is our hope this evening. He's the hope that we have throughout all eternity. Paul concludes this, and as we get ready for a prayer, I would like these words, and you've heard them before, I hope you have, maybe some of you young people haven't, but I want to share this with both young and old here again, as a reminder is what Paul is telling us about this transaction, this change in our life, that all of a sudden it's separated apart now. The corn is grown in the ground, and now the results of it. And listen to what he says here, beginning in verse 50, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I tell you this, brothers, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the perishable or the imperishable. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. I want to stop right here and tell you something that was very meaningful to me. The first time this passage had true meaning to me, and I say this with all humility, was when John Bennett's mother, Eloise Bennett, was teaching a Sunday school class. She was an adult Sunday school teacher with us, and she prepared. She prepared like she did everything else in her life. She prepared. And she had to stop. I remember it just as we're sitting here right now. To know that those who have died will one day come back to life. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trump will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. I remember Sister Eloise Bennett just stopping and saying, that will be astounding for the whole world, for those who are alive when the Lord comes back again, to see the dead raised back up again. That will be an astounding. We see all this of those who are dying, but for those who are died in the Lord, they will be resurrected at the return of Christ. And the Bible describes it, Paul does, for this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on the immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? And the sting that is mentioned here is the sting of like a viper that would go all the way back to the beginning of time when Satan as a serpent came in. It would be like something that would sting. And you know, for some, we don't have, but you know, the sting of death can have an eternal effect on any of us. The sting of death can have an eternal effect if we don't have the forgiveness of it. You see, Christ's forgiveness is the balm in Gilead. It is the healing ointment for this world that we live in. Listen what he concludes here. The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is in the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, be immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that the Lord, that in the Lord, your labor is not in vain. What we're doing and how we're conducting these days that we're living in right now will be a great reward for those who continue to work and continue to endeavor in these days that we live in. Would you bow your heads, please? Dear Lord, we are so grateful this evening for this time that we've had together to share with family, to share with friends, those that have come from some distance, brothers that are here, other family members that are here, Lord. But you know, Lord, most of all, we thank you that your presence is here. Your word tells us that you are an ever felt present in the time of need. And I pray, God, for the family members here as we look at this time of the life of John, and I have many good thoughts, Lord, of the things that you have done in his life. But Lord, I know his family, his daughter, his stepchildren, and Lord, his grandchildren, Lord, that may not have gotten to know everything they need to know about their grandfather. Lord, I pray for them, Lord, in the days ahead. And I render my person to be up there with them, to share with them photographs and memories and times that I spent with John. And I thank you, Lord. I thank you for that, Lord. For we know that our kinship and our kindred and our likeness and you that we get to spend with each other on planet Earth, Lord, is just counted time. But Lord, I long one day, Lord, to spend all of eternity with him. And others, Lord, his mother and his father and Scott, Lord, that I loved and I'm so thankful for all of them, Lord. But as I look around, I see many, many others, Lord, that I have known that have gone on to be into your presence, Lord. And Lord, even at this point in time, Lord, we just commend the memory of John Bennett into your hands, Lord, helping us, Lord, and securing your love around each and every one of the family and friends, Lord, here to love us, Lord, and that we can love you and that we can learn how to better love each other, Lord, and even to love our enemies as your word teaches us. We thank you so much, Lord, for this family. Lord, I ask your blessings over each and every one of them. And at this given time, Lord, I just commend John into your hands, Lord, and ask you, Lord, to embrace him and to welcome him into your presence is my prayer and my desire, Lord. And I pray, God, that each and every one of us can be prepared so that whether or not we meet each other again on planet Earth or we meet each other in heaven, that we will all be prepared to meet you. We love you and we thank you for your word. We ask you now to take these words and comfort us with them, Lord. And Lord, that we can walk in the assurance of our relationship with you as we read your word. Go with us now and again bless this family and comfort them. We ask all of this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you.